It's Ocean Drive in Coney Island.
Ocean Drive is the only luxury rentals in New York with a spectacular ocean view. You wake up in the morning and breathe that ocean air. I'll certify that you're going to live 10 years longer. When I became successful, I wanted to live on the ocean. If you have worked hard, you deserve an apartment on Ocean Drive too. Go to OceanDriveNYC.com and reward yourself.
If you're a policeman, fireman, doctor, nurse, or teacher, you qualify for a limited time offer at Ocean Drive NYC. Terms and conditions apply.
So Curtis and Nancy Sliwa, your upcoming hosts here on the Rip and Read. And guys, you were the ones who first flagged this for me. It's an incredible story in terms of how they caught the guy. But an illegal immigrant from Ecuador has been arrested in the rape of a 13-year-old girl in Queens. And let's get the story of how that happened from the number one vigilante couple in America, Nancy and Curtis Sliwa.
Well. So the fact that we knew he was going to turn out to be a migrant and illegal alien, right? And people say, whoa. Well, he is. And a good vigilante response, good Samaritan response, because a guy named Jeffrey Flores is in his store. And he sees the guy come in every day. Every day. Almost the same pattern every day to buy the same product. He doesn't call the cops. Even though his friend has shown him on Instagram that photo of him on his bicycle that was very clear cut. Now, it wasn't based on the sketch, because when you actually compare the sketch to the video, it really doesn't match up. That's why you can't depend on sketches. Too many guys have been jacked up in the past on a sketch. Now that we have really good technology, videos and photographs, it's a much better way of pinning responsibility on the people who did it. It's clear it's this guy. So do you think he calls 911? This is what the police tell you. Call 911. We'll get there. Hell no. Him and his friends grab this guy, slam him. He drags him out of the store, and then with his belt ties him up. Naturally, there's a bit of a scuffle. His shirt is ripped off. So when you see him being dragged into the precinct, you know, as he does the perp walk, as all the media is waiting there, people wondering, how come he doesn't have a shirt on? How come we could see that tattoo, that boar tattoo, remember, with the flaming red eyes? That's because the citizens took him down. The citizens made a citizen's arrest. The police did a great job in this case, but it was the citizens who finished it off. And that's what we have to encourage more and more and more. I don't want to hear, oh, it's a vigilante act. You should have called 911. Let the professionals deal with it. You couldn't have handled it any better than Jeffrey Flores and his fellow community citizens who took the law into their own hands. That's right. They did. And it was for the best interests of the city. I applaud them. Didn't Sean Puff Daddy Combs send back the keys to the city finally to Eric Adams?
He did have to return them, I think, yes.
So how about a set of keys to the city to Jeffrey Flores, right? Yeah, take those Sean Puff Daddy Combs keys, which were a waste of time giving it to him, and give it to a real great citizen of New York, a great hero, Jeffrey Flores. I mean, come on. This is what we should encourage. This is what happened when the Night Stalker was caught in Los Angeles. He had killed 14 people in 84. And it was a mob of citizens in East L.A. who had seen his real picture, finally, on Spanish-language TV. And they say, El Matador, El Matador. And they were running and grabbing him and beating him down in the Boyle Heights section of East L.A. Encourage that. Yeah. Great. This is how you resolve. And this is what they fear the most, the criminals. They don't fear the police. Police aren't going to do anything but cuff them. Cuff them, Daniel. They fear the mob. Because when the mob comes for you, there's a bit of a pain compliance that they administer along the way. Great job. Great job, Jeffrey Flores and all the citizens. I'm sure we're going to find out more about this. By the way, Nancy, this illegal alien, apparently he had a number of priors, didn't he?
Yeah, so the police say that the person of interest had several prior arrests along with a couple of summons in New York City since he entered the country in 2021.
Now, you would have thought if he had been arrested a few times before that ICE would have been summoned to take him away. And after he was adjudicated on his charges, then they would have sent him to his country of origin, Ecuador. You've been to Ecuador, haven't you?
I have.
Nice places in Ecuador?
Very nice places.
Where have you been in Ecuador?
Quito.
Okay, Quito, right. A lot of Americans go there, you know, they call it a medical vacation, dental, medical, it's great.
There's a lot of medicines down there.
Exactly. So how come Wannabet ICE was never contacted about this enemy of society? Wannabet, James Flippin?
I would not be surprised to find out that ICE was not contacted.
They never are.
Yeah.
They never are. There is no working relationship. Our elected officials will not permit it. Kathy Hochul, Eric Adams, the city council, the state legislature, they will not permit ICE, the federal agency, that will snatch up these illegal aliens after they've been adjudicated.
And wait, if he's been before the NYPD like several times, they would have the tattoo like on their file, right? It's like it reminds like 48 hours, right? You know, like they arrest someone. So how come they weren't able to match up the tattoo they already had on file for him?
You ask a very good question, Nancy. But you see, if ICE were involved, this would have all been taken care of. But James Flippin, of course, you're not going to deal with that aspect of it, are you?
Well, I mean, I've heard, you know, some audio that's been played before on this show in which it was expressed that ICE are a bunch of thugs. And that
that's Andrew Evil Ice Cuomo, right? Of course. And that's all the rest of them, all the Democrats who think that ICE are a bunch of thugs. But now let's flip to the big Democrat who was indicted yesterday by the attorney general in your state, New Jersey. What's his name? George?
George Norcross.
Oh, yeah, George Norcross. At one time, Bobby Menendez, the most crooked U.S. senator, who's now on trial by the U.S. attorney in the Southern District and will be found guilty, controlled the northern part of New Jersey. And George, what's his name again?
Norcross.
Norcross controlled the southern part of New Jersey, right? And they basically divided up the spoils and pickpocketed all the citizens, whatever George and Bobby wanted, George and Bobby got. In fact, El Jefe, Chris Christie, was friendly with him, even though he was a Republican. And the present mayor, Governor Murphy, half in the bag Murphy, was at war with George Norcross. All of a sudden, you know, Norcross said, yeah, he thinks he can rule by thuggery. He thinks he's the king of England. And then all of a sudden, Murphy wanted his wife to become the U.S. Senator to replace Menendez, Tammy Faye Baker Murphy. And now all of a sudden, Murphy needed George Norcross. So Murphy was saying, oh, no, George Norcross is a stand-up guy. He's number one, second to none. George Norcross was saying about Murphy, maybe one of the greatest governors we've had of all time. That's why I say don't trust any politicians. They're fake, phony, fraudulent fugazis. And at yesterday's reading of the indictment, who was sitting in the front row staring at the attorney general like the head of organized crime? Who was it there, James Flippin?
I believe it was old George and some of his associates, right?
George Norcross, all of his thug associates, and all their lawyers sitting right behind just fornicating and mad-dogging the attorney general like, yo, you were appointed by Murphy. We own Murphy. You understand that? We own Murphy. You going to indict us? I mean, have you ever seen anything so ballsy in your life?
Well, I mean, look, you've highlighted on this program many times the corruption that runs rampant in New Jersey. And, yeah, I mean, I guess these guys figure that they've gotten away with it this long. What's going to stop them now? I mean, you think of Menendez, for example. Yeah, he's on trial in New York for bribery and corruption, but he already beat it once. Yeah, it was a hung trial, whatever it was, hung jury 5-6 years ago.
And you know who testified against him? The previous attorney general of the state of New York, the seat.
You're talking about this, Ravi Bala.
Ravi Bala was the mayor of Hoboken. I'm talking about the former attorney general.
Derbier Graywall.
Right. He was seat.
Yeah.
He testified against Bobby Menendez in this trial.
That's
in
right.
Which he said, Menendez called me up and asked me to fix the case of his grifter Armenian wife, who was driving, probably impaired, and killed somebody, and then he tells me to fix it, make it go away. You see this? Bobby Menendez, George Norcross, two of the most corrupt individuals who ever walked the earth, and yet Jersey folks will keep electing Democrats.
Well, but George Norcross was he actually an elected official? He was like a power broker.
His brother is a congressman.
Oh, okay.
or son, one of the Northerns.
Whatever.
By the way, his brother was indicted with him also.
Yeah, he was.
Gee, which is the good Norcross? Try to figure that out. Oh, by the way, remember, it was George Norcross who was grabbed out of his field box at Philadelphia Eagles Stadium. Remember when he had the Israeli and American flag outside?
I was trying to remember why that name was so familiar to me. Oh, you've been giving Justin the business about that for the better part of a year now.
They dragged him out of his box while Shamuel Hefe, Chris Christie, was there rooting for the Dallas Cowboys against Philly. The owner of the Philadelphia Eagles, Jewish. He's got Black Lives Matter everywhere in the stadium, but God forbid an American and Israeli flag together. That's it. Drag them out. So you know who Sid is supporting in this case. King David II. That crook, George Norcross, sitting right there eyeballing the Attorney General saying, I own the governor who appointed you. You know who you just indicted? You're going to pay a price for this.
Talk Radio 77 WABC.
Curtis Sliwa. Curtis Sliwa. Rip and Reed.
Check this out. This is the Rip and Reed featuring Curtis Sliwa.
Talking about.
Now to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa. This is the Rip and Reed.
This song applies specifically to what just happened. As the story is unfolding, the illegal alien from Ecuador, who the video was played last night, and obviously on social network it reverberated, Spanish language, English language, of the person responsible for abducting the two 13-year-old Asian children coming out of their school right by Casino Park, forcing them into a more darkened area of the park, tying them up with his shoelaces, and then sexually molesting and raping the young girl, stealing their cell phones, telling them, in 20 minutes, if you leave within 20 minutes, I'm going to find your parents, I'm going to kill them, and then he fled. And we had a sketch. And ladies and gentlemen, that's why sketches, although they're helpful, they can lead you into a different direction than the suspect himself. And sometimes innocent people get arrested on sketches as they did years ago. But through modern technology, we have cameras everywhere, videos, photographs, photo recognition technology. When the authorities decide to use it, you can pretty much catch the person who was responsible. And in this case, it is the citizens who grabbed this enemy of society, this illegal alien. The citizens. First off, Nancy, with the late-breaking details, we now have a name of this Ecuadorian illegal. What is his name?
So, Christian Giovanni Landy.
And I always say never trust anybody with three names. What's that name again?
Christian Giovanni Landy.
And he's how old?
25 years old.
25 years old. What do we know about him in terms of when he got here into the country illegally and what he has done since?
Okay, so this was in 2021 that he entered the country. There's a little bit of a conflict in terms of whether his several prior arrests were in New York City or not. Although they're for sure they're saying that there were several summons of him in New York City. It may have been arrests elsewhere. And also he's been identified as living at a men's migrant shelter in Queens. Now, this would be somewhere near Waldron and 108th Street. They don't identify the actual shelter, but it's in that area. And so based on the good, the Good Samaritans, they had recognized him and they had noticed that he was going to a deli in Corona. So he started about 2 weeks ago, and so these Good Samaritans were lying in wait, hoping that he would return to this deli, go shopping again. And this happened early this morning at 1 a.m. when they were able to confront him and detain him. And when he tried to run, One now, this was Jeffrey Flores. He was there. He said Landy tried to run, but then he took his friend's belt and they tied up Landy's legs. And they were able to detain him until the cops got there.
His pal, Flores' pal, had shown him the photo that was released last night when we were at Kissimmee Park, of the attacker on Instagram. So this came about through social networking.
Mm-hmm.
So now what did Flores and his pals decide to do who frequented this bodega in Corona?
Well, yeah. So what they realized was that he might just return there because he had been shopping there consistently for about 2 weeks. So they were there sort of waiting in the area, waiting in the deli area. And he did show up last night sometime after midnight. And that's when they had, you know, seen him. They recognized him. They started to approach him. And then he starts to attempt to run away. Now this is outside. They have to tackle him. And they were able to actually tie his legs together with a belt until the cops got there as they restrained him. So based on that, you know, they had the picture of him walking into the precinct. He looks, you know, like a little disheveled, but more or less fine. But apparently now he's being treated at Elmhurst Hospital for his wounds.
And as you see him being marched into the precinct on the perp walk, he has no shirt on, obviously lost that in the struggle with the vigilantes, who I applaud.
One shoe.
And you can see what we most knew about him that was correct in the identification. The wild-haired boar with the flaming red eyes is right on his shoulder. So the children gave a perfect identification of this suspect. Now, just imagine if they had done what the cops usually tell you. Don't take matters into your own hands. Call 911. The place would have been flooded with uniformed cops. So this Mutt Skell, who obviously had a pattern of activity, which was to go to this bodega every time, the same time, every night, would have, A, have seen all the cops in the area, would have avoided going into that bodega, would have realized, mm-hmm. Uh-oh. Something's wrong here.
Correct.
Now, the cops would have eventually caught him. There's no doubt about it. But that's why when you see a suspect and you have the wherewithal like Jeffrey Flores and his friends did, I'm not saying if you don't have the wherewithal, you take matters into your own hands, but they had a plan. The guy's going to walk in here, we're going to jump him. They dragged him outside. He struggled. Then they hogtied him with their belts. And then they called the police, and then the police arrived and took him away. They have to be applauded. The guy may have been on the lam if he had seen cops hanging out at the bodega or flooding the bodega because of the 911 call. Hey, we've seen him there. Now, the second thing is, what time did this take place at night?
Well, this was around 1 a.m. when he actually was, grabbed and held.
So he's staying at a migrant shelter or what may be a regular shelter. We're still not sure of that. It's supposed to be a curfew, and the curfew is supposed to be 10 o'clock at night. So I would bet you on a regular basis he was violating curfew because they don't enforce it in many of these migrant shelters. They don't do background checks. They don't do fingerprint checks. You show up, you claim you're a migrant. Hey, guess what? The sucker taxpayers are going to put you up all night long and provide you with meals, and we're not going to ask any questions. Plus, he had a record. We don't know extensively how violent it was or where it had transpired, but we do know that at no point was ICE brought into this situation like, hey, we got an illegal alien here who's committed crimes. ICE has to be made known aware of this. But because we're a sanctuary city and a sanctuary state, we do not inform ICE under any circumstance. And that's why a lot of these criminal illegal aliens are able to skirt the law because they know, hey, ICE is the one we fear because ICE eventually could end up deporting us, in this case, back to Ecuador. Again, I can't salute the citizens more. Jeffrey Flores and his pals there in Corona, it sort of reminds me of what I experienced in Los Angeles when we were hunting the night stalker, Richard Ramirez, who had killed 14 people by doing home invasions. They didn't have a good picture of him for a full year. Break-ins, 14 people killed. Finally, there was a photo published in Spanish media. And some of the older women said to the crowd in the area in East L.A., Boyle's Height, El Matador, there. And they all jumped him, and they were beating the hell out of him. And the LAPD came, dragged him away. He was sentenced to the death penalty in San Quentin and died before he could be gassed. But that was another great situation where the citizens did not call 911, the LAPD, and wait for them to get there. They took matters into their own hands. This is what the criminal fears the most. The reaction of citizens. They never fear citizens because they always know citizens tend to be docile. They've been trained not to get involved. They've been trained not to get physical. They've been trained not to grab anyone. That the only ones they have to fear are the police. And oftentimes by the time the 911 call is made, they fled.
And I'm sure the citizen response really came, you know, because of the severity of this situation. I mean, I'm glad that people were out there. I mean, believe it or not, even the NYPD chief of patrol said, great community response, that's what you want. So I guess that is an endorsement for doing stuff exactly this way.
Let's make sure that they endorse this kind of activity all the time because it's the only real fear that criminals have in this city because they don't fear DAs. They don't fear getting arrested by Alvin Bragg. They don't fear being prosecuted, because oftentimes they're cut loose. They need to fear citizens. So bravo. In fact, take the keys to the city that was sent back by Sean Puff Daddy Combs to Eric Adams and give it to Jeffrey Flores and give a set of keys to every one of Jeffrey Flores' buddies there in Corona who helped hog tie and take down this enemy of society because they truly deserve the keys to the city.
Talk Radio 77 WABC. Now, to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
Curtis doesn't know about you, but he rips and reads.
This is the Rip and Read.
Welcome to the jungle. We got fun and games. We got everything you want. How do we know the names? We are the people that can find whatever you may need. If you got the money, honey, we got your disease. Jungle.
This should become the theme, Gotham, New York City today. It is, as Axl Rose and Guns N' Roses sang, a jungle, and not just because of what took place in Kissimmee Park. No. We're talking about all five boroughs, and especially on the island of Manhattan. We've come full circle because when I was a kid in about 1962, one of my favorite TV programs was The Naked City.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're about to see The Naked City. I'm Burt Leonard, the producer. As you see, we're flying over an island, a city, a particular city. And this is a story of a number of people and a story also of the city itself. It was not photographed in a studio. Quite the contrary. The actors played out their roles in the streets and in the apartment houses of New York, on the docks in the East River, and in Pennsylvania Station.
And it was based on stories from the crime blotter of the 65th Precinct. But let's start with the concept of a naked city, of people just walking around naked, flashing their anatomical wares. And Nancy, you were subjected to that just within the last 24 hours.
Yes, sadly, actually, I was. So one of my friends, James, yesterday had mentioned he was walking down the avenue and he saw some guy with his front zipper open and his whole three-piece set hanging out. I was kind of hopeful that maybe he just, you know, forgot to zip up after he went to the restroom, but I was actually really scared later on when I saw, I think it might be even the same guy. It says 1 o'clock in the morning, fully naked, walking down the street. Okay, So then he walks down the street. Then he comes back. Now he has a trench coat on after this. So he kind of classed it up a little bit for everyone. But at that point, my retinas were like fully burned. So that's a naked guy who was there.
So it was easy to see this guy. He's a white guy, right? You actually took a picture and...
For posterity.
No doubt. Just for posterity. He's like a flasher, but he's showing everything.
Yeah, I mean, there wasn't much to show, but he was showing everything. And, I mean, I don't know. Apparently, I think he might be just a regular who walks around the neighborhood naked.
And no doubt, not getting pinched by the police because they're told not to arrest people who do that. He's probably emotionally disturbed, like so many who roam around like zombies. So typical of this city that is out of control. But just within the last 24 hours, you've had a whole litany of situations that you've come across, both in the streets and subways.
Yeah, so there's normally this individual at 50th Street Station, the one train, who's below ground, and he's always shooting up, unfortunately, at the end of the station. Well, this morning, he decided that he wanted to stand at the turnstile and just randomly scream at everyone who was coming in. Like, he wasn't making any requests or demands, just screaming at everyone as they walked in. And then I do go down to the lower platform, and there's a kid going to school. He's just smoking a big blunt. It's, like, stinky as all anything. Then the train doors, he gets in the cab, still the MTA subway car, still smoking. Everyone's got their suits on. Everyone's going to work. So that was no big deal. The night before, I had to go to Duane Reade to get something. And I realized, like, I'm waiting online to buy. And I realized, like, a shadow on me. Like, this guy's standing so close to me. It's, like, literally bothering me. And I turn around. I realize he's trying to use me as a shield so that he can steal stuff. I'm like, I told him, don't use me as no buffer. Like, I'm not going to be covering your illegal activities. So I started moving away from him. Eventually, then he just put his object that he was trying to steal on the counter and walked out of the store. But yeah, that was all within, I think, less than 48 hours I've seen this.
Right, the Naked City. So first person, the flasher.
The flasher.
Who ends up with the rain jacket on, but fully exposing himself.
Yeah, never the people you want to see flashing.
He's the white guy walking around like he owns the city. Then the guy on the platform of 50th Street that you normally see, you've taken a picture of him shooting up into his toes.
Yeah, his toes.
Because he's run out of all kinds of veins to shoot up in. Now he's gone topside and he's screaming like a maniac.
Screaming.
Nobody does anything to him.
Screaming.
The young person who's smoking the blunt, what color is he?
He was dark-skinned.
All right. Dark skin, black or Hispanic.
Yeah, well,
and then you finally get to the last local yokel there. And what is he? He's a white guy.
White guy. He looked like he was in his maybe 50s or 60s, a little bit, disheveled. But yeah, like I said, right up on top of me. Like I thought he was trying to rob me. I just didn't realize he was using me as a shield.
And was the security guard eyeballing him at all?
You know what's funny? There was a security guard who was walking back and forth. And yet didn't actually approach or do anything with the people in the line, which is weird. I have no idea. Like, I mean, because to me, it looked pretty obvious, like, what he was doing. But, yeah, no, he just walked back and forth, and that was it.
So there's four separate situations in this naked city.
Frightening.
But that's only one of many. There was Steve Sharippa the other day. Bobby Bacala was on with Sid Rosenberg. Great interview, I might add. In which Bobby Bacala was talking about simply a stretch of 8th Avenue from about 32nd Street up to 57th Street.
Are you confident that New York will be back? He says it's back already.
No, I think we're doomed.
Really?
I'm not confident at all. I think we're finished. I think it's so broke it can't be fixed.
Really?
That's what I see. When I walked, I took a walk. I mean, I walk all over the city, you know that. But for some reason, I wind up on 8th Avenue. You go from 8th Avenue, you walk up there, you're in hell, man. You're in hell. Go like from 34th Street, 33rd Street, 32nd Street, up to 57th. You're in hell.
It's true. The junkies.
It's horrible.
The
there's
homeless.
Junkies. There's beggars. There's junkies. There's migrants. I mean, we're giving the migrants money. We put them in a hotel. We give them phones so they could rob us. They're here to rob us. They're not here like our ancestors to do better and to make better lives for themselves. They found a bunch of suckers, and we're it.
Great. And it's a perfect observation, Steve Sciarippa, a.k.a. Bobby Bacala, is a citizen. He's obviously a great actor, but he was just saying this as citizen Bobby Bacala of New York City. But remember your story, Nancy. Bobby Bacala's story is just one of many stories.
There are 8 million stories in the Naked City. This has been one of them.
So 8 million stories, and they're all very similar. Fear, fright, hysteria, and flight. Fear, fright, hysteria, and flight. As many of our fellow New Yorkers have fled and continue to flee Gotham because of what you've described, Nancy, what Steve Sciarippa has described, what we saw take place in Kissimmee Park, in which the illegal alien was grabbed by the citizens. They are heroes. Some will say that's a vigilante act. You should have called the police. No, they took matters into their own hands. We know who this guy is. He's going to come into this bodega in Corona like he always does at night. And we're going to grab him, and we're going to hogtie him and hold him here, and then we'll call the police. I applaud that. But then out of the 8 million stories, there's always one or two contrarians who see things differently. And that is Eric Adams, swagger man with no plan.
We are doing a good job. I walked down 34th and 8th Avenue. I was on the street, walking down, talking to those who were living in those conditions. And Michael, I don't remember the faces of all of them. You know, I met a lot of people when I was walking that day on 8th Avenue, 34th Street at 10 p.m. And there are limitations of what we could do. If someone is just sitting there and they are under the influence of drugs, we can't lock them up. You know, there are real rules on what we can do, and we have to abide by those rules, and that's what we're doing.
Does he realize most of them aren't just sitting there? They move.
Of course. He has no idea. The only reason he would ever experience going to 8th Avenue between 32nd and 57th, like Steve Sciarippa described.
At 10 p.m., too. Mm-hmm.
Right. As if there's some restaurant opening up and he's getting a free meal, or it's a nightclub and he's there till the break of dawn. He's delusional. But wait, he doesn't finish. You know, he's an expert on 8th Avenue.
It is a challenge because of how our laws are written in this city. You cannot walk up to someone that appears to be under the influence of some substance and state that you're going to remove them from where they are. We're using every tool possible. That's an important piece of real estate, and we want to continue to attract tourism, which we are doing, but we have to do it within the law.
Yeah, tourists, they're flooding here. They read story after story of getting robbed by Venezuelans in Times Square. They're flooding here. By the way, they count illegal aliens, migrants in the hotels that we pay for. They count them as tourists.
Yeah, because that's a hotel occupancy rate. So it looks really good on paper, but it's really distorting the reality of the situation.
There are guests, and we pay for them. And then some of them turn around and return the favor by robbing us or beating us. This mayor's delusional. A, I know City Hall listens. The lead editorial in today's New York Post is about the strip on 8th Avenue that Steve Sciarippa described. And they said, Mr. Mayor, do something. Don't tell us there's nothing you can do. Because when the mayor says to the cops, and there's nothing that we can do. Then what do the cops say? There's nothing we can do. And then you end up with more fear, fright, hysteria, and flight.
Check this out. It's the Riff and Reed featuring Curtis Sliwa. Talk Radio 77 WABC.
We all hear the radio ads about the IRS. They tell you to be afraid, to be scared, and they try to frighten you into calling. I'm not here to do that. Tax Relief Advocates is different. TRA is here to tell you that if you owe money to the IRS, whether it's $5,000, $50,000, or $500,000, we have a solution. It doesn't matter if you're sitting in your car, at work, or with your kids, no matter where you are, call now. 800-579-9068. Don't lose hope. TRA can eliminate or reduce what you owe to the IRS. Generous programs are now available that can give you a fresh start. Our passion is taxes and helping individuals fix their IRS problems.
We have over 1,000 five-star reviews on Google and an A-plus with the Better Business Bureau.
You don't need to be afraid of the IRS any longer. End your tax nightmare today by visiting us online at TRA.com or call 800-579-9068. That's 800-579-9068. Tax Relief Advocates, real solutions for real people.
Attention, if you have Medicaid and live in New York and need assistance with daily living, you can receive a 100% free service and get help in the comfort of your own home by a loved one. Call Freedom Care now so you can receive daily help preparing meals, bathing, doing laundry, receiving transportation, and more. All done by a family member or friend that gets paid to be your caregiver. You get to decide who provides your care, and your caregiver gets paid instantly after their shift. It's all funded by Medicaid, so it's 100% free to you. Call in the next 10 minutes to see if you qualify. The Freedom Care family will explain the process, making it stress-free for patients and caregivers. Freedom Care is number one in New York and has received over 4,000 five-star reviews. They've been helping families for years. This service is 100% free to you through Medicaid. So call right now and see how fast you can get started with Freedom Care.
Call 516-447-2106. 516-447-2106.
Listen to this podcast now on the Red Apple Podcast Network. The Andrew Giuliani Show.
One of my favorite people in the White House, former deputy press secretary and deputy communications director in the White House, also former deputy assistant treasury secretary, Brian Morgenstern.
Andrew, buddy, great to be with you. Just when you see the media coverage, it's infuriating.
Yeah.
Because it's all, oh, Israel being too cruel. Release the hostages. Hamas.
No, that's it.
Release the hostages.
Release the hostages.
And release the hostages. Retreat. This didn't have to. You know when there was peace? October 6th.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, that was a ceasefire.
Yeah.
On October 6th.
Yeah.
That existed. So it's very upsetting to see pressure come down on Israel. They didn't start this fight.
Yeah.
But they sure as heck should find a way to finish it, hopefully quickly and as nonviolently as possible. But when you're attacked the way they've been attacked, you have to defend yourself.
Download all of Red Apple Media's podcasts right now through your favorite podcast platform. Talk Radio 77 WABC. Now to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
Curtis doesn't know about you, but he rips and reads.
This is the Rip and Read.
Perfect song for whenever we discuss The Mask Issue by Billy Idol. Grapevine by Lou Ruffino. So that'll be the theme song because this is going to be an endless conversation. And now Eric Adams, Swagger Man with No Plan, has weighed in. He's trying to say he was always ahead of the curve. He always wanted that mask initiative that was put into place during COVID and the lockdown of 2020 to be removed. And at the press conference yesterday, he reiterated that. In fact, it was the first time I ever heard him say it.
I had several conversations with the governor, and I talked about the mask issue for some time now. I asked storekeepers to have people pull down their mask before even temporarily.
So in March of 2023, there was a spate of killings of bodega workers and owners, slashings. People would come in masks. They'd all be hoodied up. They'd have masks on. And so Eric Adams' response was, look, you tell anybody coming into your bodega before they walk in that store to take the mask down so you could see them. That lasted all of 30 seconds when the bodega owners say, okay, and if they resist, which most of them are going to do, when we call 911, will we get preferential treatment to that call? No. That's how long that lasted. And I'm surprised that the reporters didn't follow up with questions, because I would have said, Mr. Mayor, with no enforcement, that doesn't work.
That was another failed pilot program, I think.
Another failed. That lasted 30 seconds. Then he continued on like he has been the strongest champion of removing masks from people.
And it's all about a question. You know, someone has a mask and they ask if you're wearing a mask for health reasons, people could respond. So it's all about the proper implementation. And the law was in place. It was in place. It was removed after COVID. I'm a strong supporter of the decision of stopping masks on our subway system, masks in protests, and mask in other areas where it's not health related.
Yeah, I don't seem to ever remember that.
Yeah, me neither, actually.
And then he finished with the coup de resistance.
Cowards cover their faces. If you believe in something, then stand up and show your face and believe it and talk about it.
I mean, that's fairly interesting, because when all of those people, back when initially the mask and the lockdown happened and people were trying to show their faces because they didn't want to be on lockdown, they didn't want to take the vaccine, like, those people got persecuted, and you still persecute them. So very, very big change in thought process by this man.
Oh, absolutely. He was all over them.
Yeah.
They lost their jobs. They lost their mortgages. They lost their careers. They haven't been hired back.
Yeah.
So he was, like, vicious with that. But you see, this is typical of all politicians. They think that everyone will forget. You haven't, Nancy, and a lot of our listeners haven't. But they believe, and these I've shared discussions with Republicans and Democrats where they've told me, yeah, they're like sheep. They'll forget what you said 5 seconds ago, 5 minutes ago, 5 hours ago, 5 days ago, 5 weeks ago, 5 months ago, 5 years ago. They're all sheep, and they need us sheep herders. But guess what? We don't. Here's a woman concerned in Casino Park now that the cops will be removing themselves because they can't keep that presence. What's going to happen now that this monster has been caught?
Now I'm getting scared because not NYPD is not everywhere. They're just here because the crime scene happened. But what if the NYPD moves from here? What do I do? Like, maybe I would stop coming.
Well, have no fear. We were there at Casino Park yesterday with some of the law and order GOP candidates in the area who were running to put back $1 billion that was taken from the police budget so we can hire more police and to end no cash bail. But Nancy, as I was talking to the crowd there, I said, look, eventually the police will leave here because they're chasing crime all over the city. Like last night when I was in Brownsville on Powell and Livonia, where two elderly people had been shot the night before. I said, we will have Guardian Angel patrols here in Casino Park. From nearby Flushing, it's mostly Asian guardian angels. But more importantly, we're going to start training parents and grandparents to do a parent guardian angel watch. So when the kids get out of school, when school returns in late August and early September, they can flood the park and they can protect their children and their grandchildren, because we know at this rate, with only 32,000 cops, and you need at least 38,000, that you're never going to have enough cops to be in that park like they were for this emergency. The cops did a good job. The citizens did the best job by catching this monster, hog-tying him, holding him down, and then calling the police. But now the Guardian Angels will continue the job as the police leave, and the community needs to be kept safe.